Jacobite Rising was put down, the Dress Act of 1748 confined the use of tartan for over 30 years to the army. The purpose of the act was to drive a wedge between the people of the Highlands and their traditional form of dress. And in this it succeeded only too well. By the time the act was repealed in 1783, many of the old customs and traditions of the Highlands had disappeared forever. It has been said that it was not until a glow of post-Jacobite sentiment caused by the novels of Sir Walter Scott that made the assumption of tartan respectable, that anybody but a Highlander would have wanted to wear it. This point of view is best exemplified by the Lowland Laird, who when asked, does your family have a tartan, replied vehemently, no, thank God, my ancestors were all able to afford trousers. It is a paradox of Scottish history that the age which saw the gradual decay of the Highlands also created an interest in them. It would be foolish to pretend that Sir Walter alone was responsible for the Celtic revival, but he gave it impetus and lent it distinction. He engineered a visit to Edinburgh in 1822 of George IV, who tried his best to play the part of that other prince who, less than a century before, had set the whole city ablaze. There were drawing room soirees every day, and the Highlands came into their own again. It is an evening such as those which we seek to recreate for the first part of our programme, if not in full authenticity, then at least in spirit, while the second part shows its modern equivalent. It is said that the bells of this very church inspired Lady Mary to write the words for our first song, Caller Hill.
Three. fashions was given a further royal seal of approval when Queen Victoria started to spend regular holidays at Balmoral. She liked to see her family in Highland things, and her journal records being late for dinner due to Albert's struggles to dress in the kilt. Her first visit to Scotland took place in 1842. Her Majesty arrived on the 4th on Wednesday 31st August, and landing at Granton next morning before 8 o'clock, drove through the city to Dalkeith Palace. In consequence as to a misunderstanding as to the hour of her landing, Sir James Forrest, Lord Provost, and the members of the City Council were not present to receive the Queen at the city boundary and to present her with the keys. This episode was made the subject of a humorous ballad. Come to Granton here, they promised, and the Baileys here. They're in their beds a muckle here, say early in the morn.
Hi, Jimmy Fox, are you walking in? Are you big snoring yet? If you were walking, oh, one wicked day, oh, very, very
born. The frigate guns, they loud did roar, but louder did the Baileys snore, and thought it was an unco to rise, say early in the morn. Shin the castle thundered loud, but kippers, it is savoury food, and that the Baileys understood, say early in the morning.
When she's come to Brandon Street, the provost and the keys they meet, and if you think that she's too wet, you're walking in the morning. And Jimmy Forrest, are you walking in, and are you being snoring yet? If you were walking on a wicked day, oh, very, very warm.
My lord, the queen is here, and wow, my lord, it looking queer, and which sets her say soon a steer, it's barely 9 in the morn.
Hi, Jimmy Forrest,
I'm
walking in, and are you baby snoring yet? If you were walking on one wing, you'd be home very, very warm.
Bring to me my robes of state, come Baileys, we won't catch her yet. Run, run, my lord, you're hourly, she's been through the tomb this morning. What did Alkid Eamon fly and mark your best apology? The Queen shall say,
oh, why, oh, my, you're lazy, oh, you're a man. Hey, Jimmy Forrest, are you walking yet? And are you baby snoring yet? We were walking on our way. Yeah, we are very, very
thank you.
Queen Victoria's visit to Scotland. Sir Walter Scott's border romances further heightened Victorian appreciation of Scotland and inspired a passion for Scottish history and folklore. His readers doted on narrative poems such as The Lay of the Last Minstrel. Breathes there a man with soul so dead, who never to himself has said, this is my own, my native land, whose heart hath ne'er within him burned, as home his footsteps he hath turned from wandering on a foreign strand. If such there breathe, go, mark him well, no minstrel raptures for him swell. High though his title, proud his name, boundless his wealth as wish can claim, despite those titles proud and pelt, the wretch consented all himself, living shall forfeit all renown, and doubly dying shall go down to the vile dust from whence he sprung, unwept, unhonored, and unsung. O Caledonia, stern and wild, meet nurse for a poetic child. Land of brown heath and shaggy wood, land of the mountain and the flood, land of my sires, what mortal hand can e'er untie the filial band that knits me to thy rugged strand? Still, as I view each well-known scene, think what is now and what hath been, seems as to me of life bereft. So, friends, thy woods and streams are left, and yet I love them better still, even in extremity a little. By Yarrow's grace, still let me stray, though none shall guide my feeble way. Still feel the breeze down Ettrick's brake, though it should chill my withered cheek. Still lay my head by Teviot's stone, though there, forgotten and alone, the bard may draw his parting groan.
Parlour evenings were popular among the middle classes, where one could hear over-sentimental songs, dripping with emotions of which the listeners hardly know. Mothers are dead, fathers are drunkard, and little sisters selling matches in the street. One of the few Scottish songs which you might hear at such an evening would be Annie Lloyd.
Thank you.
young Lochinvar has come out of the west, through all the white border his steed was the best, and save his good broadsword, he weapons had none. He rode all unarmed, and he rode all alone. So faithful in love and so daunting in war, there never was knight like the young Lochinvar. He stopped not for brake, and he stayed not for stain. He swam the Esk River, where ford there was none. But when he alighted at Netherby Gate, the bride had consented, the gallant come late, for a laggard in love and a dastard in war was to wed the fair Ellen of brave Lochnagar. So boldly he entered the Netherby Hall, midst bridesmen and kinsmen and brothers and all. Up spoke the bride's father, his hand and his sword, for the poor craven bridegroom said never a word. Oh, come ye in peace here, or come ye in war, or to dance at our bridals, young lord Lochnagar. A lang would your daughter, a suit you deny. Love swells like the Solway, but ebbs like its tide, and now I am come with this lost love of mine. To tread but one measure, drink one glass of wine. There are maidens in Scotland more lovely by far that would gladly be bride to young Lochinvar. The bride kissed the goblet, the knight took it up. He drank down the wine, he dashed down the cup. He took her soft hand ere her mother could bar. Now tread we a measure, said young Lochinvar. So stately his form, so lovely her face, that never a hall such a galliard did grace. While her mother did fret, and her father did fume, the bridegroom stood dangling his bonnet and plume. And the bride's maiden whispered, 'twere better by far to have matched our fair cousin with young Lochinvar. One touch to her hand, and one word to her ear, when they reached the hall door, and the charger stood near. So light to the croup the fair lady he swung, so light to the saddle before her he sprung. She is one where God over bank, bush, and scar. They'll have fleet steeds that follow, quoth young Lochinvar. There was mountings among Grahams of the Netherby clan, Forsters, Fenwicks, and Musbys, they raid and they ran. There was racing and chasing and Cannaby Lee. But the lost bride of Netherby ne'er did they see. So daring in love and said dauntless in war, have ye e'er heard of gallant like young Lochnavar? A favourite of Paul's, with which we end this part of our evening, was the dance Brigadoon. That name lives on in the same tradition of mist, hills, and romantic glens in the show Brigadoon.
Thank you.
went to your Keighley last Saturday night. And that's a party where you're on the attack. You get to dance, sing a song, or recite a few poems. It's a swarry, those are fun. Well, you tack your own bottle, and the food's all laid on by whatever it is that invited you. So when Willie McNabb says, "Would I like to go?" I says, "Thank you, lad, I'd be delighted to." T'was then I got thinking. I thought, dearie me, why'd I go and said yes? Because the last time I went to one of these things, I made such a terrible mess. All the best singers and dancers were there, and a few that could tell a grand tale. And a band brought up specially lassie. They were late because they'd come down the trail. Our thing was going fine. I was having a ball. When all of a sudden a voice rose out, "Come on, Lizzie lads, it's your turn." Well, we all sat there shouting and clapping and waiting for Lizzie to say it. And I sat there bawling and all, and I thought, "I'm glad it's no me, I can feel it." Well, nobody rose. Not a soul got up. And I says, "Here, Lizzie, where's she?" And a terrible panic was inside me right here when I realised Lizzie was me. Geordie was pushing me onto my feet, said, "Come on, lass, gee's your crack." But I sat right down and I said, "Here, take my these buttons all up the back." The twa laddies come out and they lifted me up. They each took a leg and a horn. They carried me struggling onto the floor and put me in front of the bar. Well, the noise, it got worse. I thought, what'll I do? When somebody shouted for order, and I suddenly minded the yints at the skill, I'd played corn rigs on the recorder. So I asked the band leader if he had sick a thing, but the nearest he had was a charter. Says I to him, "Thanks, but it's no quite the same. Instead, I'll recite Tam a Shanter." The band played a chord. Aye, just like that. And the rabble reverted to hush. And I stood there trembling all weak at the knees, and I felt my face start to blush. I looked in the hall at all the folk. I said, "Weel, was it in the yard for the folk?" And I was filled with this terrible feeling inside that you get when you're having the boke. I sorted my hair, picked my horns at my sides, stood up straight, and I gave a wee cough. "Tam o' Shanter," says I, "by Burrens, the bard." Took a breath, and at last I was off. But I'd hardly gone bare than the inner 12 lines when the words just went straight at my feet. I stood there, dumbfoon at fair scunner. Or in English, "Oh, I wish there was deed." Well, the crowd were all laughing, but I panicked and said, "I'll give you a fling." I bowed, probably fell flat on my face. And somebody cries, "Can you sing?" Well, that was enough. It was too much to throw. Should I got myself back on my feet? I made a hasty, but dignified exit. And went into the loo for a greet. It was there I remained for the rest of the night. I sat there all weepy and weary, and I swore to myself that I never again would attempt doing a turn at a Keighley. Weel, you'll mind who I said that I'd been asked back. Well, I went, and I had a rare tear, and I wasn't bothered about all these singers and dancers and all that were there. When my turn come round, a great cheer went up, but I sang nor recited a dotal. So what did I do, you're all wondering? I just went through the mall with my bottle.
Kissing me. Oh,
the blithe days of honeymoon, with Kate's allurement smitten, I loved her late, I loved her soon, I called her dearest kitten. But now my kitten's grown a cat, and cross like other wives. Upon my life, my honest Matt, I fear she has 9 lives. Rosemary to his lady says, Maria, Masada, O salve day the thing you came, or salve he or supple. With modest grace, say fu a grace, reply the bonny lady. My noble lord, day as you please, but supper is near ready. I noticed in a South African newspaper, 2 men were fined £120 apiece for poaching a white rhinoceros. I've poached a pickle Patrick when the leaves were turning sear. I've poached a twa three hare and grouse and whiles I've poached a deer. But eh, it seems an unca thing and just a wee mysterious. Who any mortal could contrive to poach a rhinoceros? I crack it with a keeper, poke its back with face and thighs, and I paw at any man I saw the hidden moon be through the legs. But hey, I do the best would be a wee thing deleterious. Again, you should stow until your breeds a brace of rhinoceros. I mind who me and Wally poached a royal in Braemar, and brocht him down to Athol by the licht of moon and star. And eh, sirs, but the canny beast contrived to fashion weariness. Yet stakesman be but bairns play beside a rhinoceros. I thought that came to poach it, it is muckles other men. But there is still a twa-three thing I could have never pay. But now I canna rest, my brain is going that delirious. To win a war to Africa, and poach a rhinoceros.
Thank you.
paid. His mind was seen up for things of the sea. He wanted a wife for his bra, who's to keep him, but favour with wooing was fascists. Doon by the dyke head, a lady did dwell, at his table heavy, though she should well. MacLeish's aid often, a claver's halley, a penniless lass, but we a lie and penny. His wife was weel, withered and as good as new. His waistcoat was white, his coat was blue, and he put on a ring, a sword, and cocked hat. What could refuse the laird way or that? He mounted the grey mare and raised Cannelly, rapped at the yet to Clavers Alley. Ye tell Mistress Jean's come speedily then, she's wanted to speak to the laird cock pen. Mistress Jean was marking the elder flower white. What brings the laird at such a late time? She put up her apron and on her silk goon, her much were red ribbons and gang speedily doon. And when the laird saw her, he bowed full low. And what was his business? He soon let her know. Amazed was the laird when the lady said, "Nah," and with a lady curtsy, she turned away. Dumbfounded was he, oh, nay, sighed, and he mounted his mare and he raved cannily. But often he thought as he raved through the glen, "She's deaf to refuse the laird to cock pen."